Hello, I am Alok. You are watching Micpedia. Friends, automobile is one of the fascinating subjects. Its invention makes the world revolutionized. We cannot imagine our modern world without the automobile. It is used in every aspect of our life. So I came with an introductory course on automobile, where you will get all of the basic information of the automobile. Basically, you will learn all about the basic components and its function. So those students who are currently studying in the automobile engineering in their graduate course, they can also use this course as a revision purpose. So this series is divided into 5 parts. So please subscribe this channel and press the bell icon so that you will not miss the video. So I hope you will enjoy the journey of learning. So let's start. So let's start from the classification of automobile. So automobile can be classified into several types of based on the several criteria. So it can be classified on the basis of purpose, capacity, fuel source, types of transmission, number of wheels, or number based on the side of drive. So let's start from one by one. So based on the purpose, the vehicle or automobile can be classified into two groups. So the first is a passenger vehicle and the second is a goods vehicle. So passenger vehicles are those vehicles that carry passengers. So for example, buses, car, trains, that are the passenger vehicle. And those who are used for the transportation of goods that are classified as a goods vehicle. So for example, the goods lorry, truck, that are the goods vehicle. So let's move on the other classification. So based on the capacity, there are the three types: heavy motor vehicles, light motor vehicles, and medium vehicles. So heavy motor vehicles are the bulky motor vehicles that are, for example, large trucks, buses, and light motor vehicles are those are the smaller motor vehicles, for example, cars, jeeps are, and the medium can be classified as the relatively medium sized vehicle like a small trucks, minibus, etc. So let's move on the third one. So based on the fuel sources. So on the full fuel sources, we can classify it on the basis of petrol engine vehicle, diesel engine vehicle, gas vehicles, solar vehicles, hydrogen vehicle, electric vehicles, and steam engine vehicles. So steam engine vehicle and the steam engine vehicle is basically obsolete from now. But we are basically focusing on the petrol engine and the diesel engine. Basically, both of those vehicles are used in today. But the future vehicle will be electric vehicle and the solar vehicle. Both will be the future vehicle. So in around 2025, I think 2025 to 2030, all of the vehicle will be the electric vehicle or maybe solar vehicle. So as the name suggested, the consumption of their fuel, like petrol engine vehicles are the having using the petrol. So I do not think that we have to explain this. So let's move on the next one. So based on the transmission, so on the basis of transmission, we can classify all of the automobile into three parts. So automatic transmission vehicle, conventional transmission vehicle, and semi-automatic transmission vehicle. So automatic transmission vehicles are those vehicles that are capable to changing the gear by its own. And the conventional transmission vehicle are those vehicles which need the changing the gear by manually, and the semi is the combination of both. So let's move on to another classification. So another classification is based on the number of wheels. So there may be a two wheeler, there may be three wheeler, four wheeler, six wheeler, or maybe eight wheeler, etc. So now move on the based on the drive. So based on the side of drive, so it's classified into two groups. So left hand drive automobile and the right hand drive automobile. So basically in India we are using the right hand drive automobiles, and in the USA or maybe Canada, I think So they are using the left hand drive automobile. So what are the left hand and right hand drive? So basically it is left hand drives are those automobiles that having the driver seat would be left hand side, and the right hand drive automobile are those vehicles whose driver will be sit and drive in the right hand side of the vehicle. So now let's move on the parts of an automobile. So basically the classification will be into the two parts, so machine portion and the carriage portion. And further, the machine portion is divided into three groups: the chassis and transmission system, the engine, and the electric equipments. So let's understand one by one. So chassis, it is the main, or you can say that it is a skeleton of the whole vehicle. So all of the major assemblies will be done on it. So basically, just I want to show you. So basically, this is the main chassis. Around it, all of the assembly will be going on. So just like this, the wheel or axle is assembled on this chassis. The transmission system will be assembled on this. Basically, without chassis, all of the equipments, all the component will be assembled on the chassis. So it is the backbone of the engine. So now let's move on the next. So this is the transmission system. Transmission system includes the gearbox, universal joints. So basically, the transmission system transmits the power generated by the engine to the driving wheel. So we will discuss about later in the more. So let's the third one is the engine. So the engine is basically the source of power generation in automobile or any vehicle. It generates the power, and it consists of mainly these basic system. So its engine's basic fuel system are the fuel system, ignition system, and lubrication system and cooling system. So let's understand the fuel system. So fuel system provides the fuel to the engine. Its work is to provide the much amount of fuel and air so that the engine can perform. So it mixes the petrol and air in the right proportion and send it to the cylinder, where it burns and produce energy for the petrol engine. And in the diesel engine, it has to drop the diesel to the engine in the proper amount. It incorporates all of the components from the fuel tank to the carburetor of the engine. So basically, the carburetor is also a part of fuel system. So we will see later. So let's move to the ignition system. The ignition system are the responsible to ignite the engine inside the engine in the regular manner, so that the engine can work properly. And basically, this is the photo, or you can say image, of the spark plug. So it will present in the petrol engine, and in the diesel engine there will be no any ignition system. The ignition system will be there will be ignition will be occur due to the spray of diesel at a very high pressure and temperature. So lubricating system is the one of the key system for any mechanical system. Basically, it helps in lubricating the parts of the engine so that they can work smoothly. Basically, it reduces the friction, and it also helps in the heat transfer. So it takes off the waste heat of the engine. So we will further study about this. Basically, we are just doing a brief introduction about all of the systems. So the third one is the cooling system. So cooling system is also very important. Basically, you always see like this structure. Basically, this is called the fin on the engine. So it radiates the waste heat so that the system will not buckle inside the cylinder or piston will not buckle and do not distort it due to the high temperature. So there is a electrical system. So electrical system consists of the battery, dynamo, alternator and ignition starting and lighting system. So basically the battery, you know, dynamo is basically used for the generating the electric current, and alternator is used to convert the DC to AC, and the ignition starting system is one of the very important for the engine, so that you can ignite the engine. And basically in the modern engine you will find that there is a spark plug is used as a electrical, there is a ECU system, electrical control unit, ECU. So it is basically electrical system, and we will study later on this. So performance of an automobile. So performance of an automobile depends upon the brake power. So what is brake power? Brake power is the power generated by the engine. It is the, you can say, the actual power generated by the engine. So BP, we denote the brake power as the BP. So BP is equal to 2 pi NT upon 60 into 1000 kilowatt. So where the N is the revolution, RPM, in RPM, and T is the torque in Newton meter. So the fuel burns that develop the pressure inside the cylinder, and the pressure, due to the pressure is converted into the force, and the piston will piston cylinder arrangement will be get expanded. So due to this force, there is a torque is generated. This torque is produced to produced by the engine, so that the transmission of the it transmitted to the wheel, and the when it will transmitted to the wheel, the engine will propel. So basically the torque generated, that is the brake power. So the actual power, sorry, the not the torque. So basically the actual power generated by the engine is a brake power. So that is the performance of automobile. So power to weight ratio is a very important for the performance of any automobile. So in your vehicle, the power should be greater and the weight should be less, so than that the automobile performance should be enhanced. And it is basically, you can, when the engine is designed, this is a very important thing that is kept in the mind. So let's move on the next one. So main component of IC engines. So these are the main components. These are not all components, but these are the main components. So like the cylinder block, cylinder head, cylinder liner, crankcase, oil sump or oil pan, piston, piston ring, compression ring, oil ring, connecting rods, crankshaft and camshaft. So let's understand in briefly one by one. So cylinder block, this is a cylinder block, whatever you is viewing the diagram, this is the cylinder block. It is the main block of the engine. You can say these here the engine will be assembled. Engine, I mean that the cylinder, the liner and the piston, so all of will be assembled on this. So here the important thing is the it is generally made of the gray cast iron or aluminium alloy ITC, but it is made by the process of single casting. This is a very important, and where this is the water, you are seeing the groove like structure. This is the basically for the water circulation. So there is a basically water jackets for circulating the water. So why we circulate the water? So water is circulated for the heat transfer. I actually already told you that there is a lots of heat that is wasted in the engine. So that heat will be may distort the cylinder or the piston. So that heat should be extracted from the system. So the heat is extracted by the working fluid water. So let's move on the other. So cylinder head. Cylinder head is basically the top of the, it is basically on the top of the cylinder block. So it is bolted on the cylinder block, and it consists of basically the input valve, output valve, or input port or output port, or it also consists of a spark plug and the nozzle for the in the diesel engine, and it is basically made by the single cast iron, and it in this the material used are gray cast iron or aluminium alloy etc. So let's move on the cylinder liner. So cylinder liner is very important. Basically what we are already study about the cylinder and the piston arrangements, but in actual these are the all of the we study in the books, but in actual the cylinder and the piston, the piston moves in the liner. There will be not directly contact between the piston and the engine block. So the engine block, the liner will be installed in the engine block. So here the liner will be installed. So this will be installed into that. So this has a very important role. So basically this prevent direct contact between the piston to the engine block, so that the when the piston moves, the liner will produce a friction. Piston and liner connected with each other, so it produces a friction, and due to the friction there will be heat loss, and there will be corrosion on the surface. So that the even if we directly connect the cylinder engine block to the piston, then we will find that after some time the engine block will be get corrosive, and it get basically its hole gets increased, so the engine will be not working properly. Basically there will be leakage. So for reducing the chance, we use the cylinder liner. Basically cylinder liner will be cylinder liner will be corrosive, or corrosion will be held in the cylinder, and the hole will be bigger by the piston to the cylinder liner. So we can replace it and we can reuse it. So these are the basically two types, wet liner and the dry liner. So wet liner is the liner that are surrounded by the cooling water, and it is the it provides the resisting surface to the piston to reciprocate, as the both of liner are same working, and it also works for the seal of the water jackets. Yes, it is a very important point to note that in the I already show you that in this the water is for flowing in the sidewise. So there also in the wet liner, the liner has itself itself has a grooves to circulate the water to provide the cooling. And there is a dry liner. The dry liner is directly connected to metal contact with the cylinder block, and they are not directly touching the cooling water. And basically, this system is directly radiating the heat to the engine block, and engine block will be give the heat to the wasted heat to the water. So crankcase. So this is the universal function of the crankcase, is to seal the crankcase and connecting rods from the derivatives. So basically the crankcase is the, you can say is that this is the cover of the crank, and it has maybe the cast integral with a cylinder block in the lots of, and it may not be integral with the cast block. a cylinder block. So sometime it is cast separately. I have already told you. For crank case, these materials I use are the cast iron, aluminium alloy, or the alloy steel. So oil sump or oil pan. So oil pan or oil sump is used for the contents containing the lubricants. So basically, it is the bottom part of the engine, and the drain plug or oil sump to drain the oil out of the oil. So basically, it may have a oil pump, so they can supply the oil, lubricating oil to the system, and it is basically made of the pressed steel. So we will further study about it. You have not to worry about that. So yes, the piston is acting the movable gas tight seal to keep the gas inside the cylinder, as we all know. So it transmits the force to the explosion. Basically, you can say that this is the change, this will change pressure to the force. So on the when the pressure will be increase inside the cylinder, and the piston will be moved, so that the basically you can say that it changes the pressure to force, and it is basically made of the cast iron or aluminium alloy, chromium nickel alloy, or nickel iron alloy, or cast iron steel. So moves to the piston rings. So piston rings are inserted in the groups of the provided in the piston. So this is the groups. So here the piston rings is installed. So there are two types of piston rings, compression ring and oil rings, or the oil control ring. So basically, this is the expander. Okay, so compression ring and oil rings, so we will study about that. Compression ring, it provides an effective seal to the high pressure gas inside the cylinder. Basically, it helps in developing the high pressure, and it ensures that it do not leak of any gas would be happened. So if any gas is leaked from the cylinder to the downward in the crank case, so it may be very harmful for the engine. It may get deposited on the cylinder surface or liner surface, and it can corrode the surface. So each piston is divided, provided into two compression rings, so that it ensures fully that no gas will be leakage. So oil rings or oil control rings, its working is basically to wipe the all of the excess oil from the cylinder walls. So here oil is basically the lubricating oil. So when the engine moves, the liner will always continuously provided by the lubricating oil, so that it basically ensure that the friction should be less, and the heat, the excess heat would be wiped by the help of the lubricating oil. So material used for the piston rings should be wear resistant, so that it wear the temperature and pressure. Normally piston rings are made of the alloy steel iron containing silicon or manganese alloy steel. Now moves on the connecting rod. As you see that this is the connecting rod, and it can connects the piston and the crankshaft. So piston you had already shown, and this is the crankshaft. So it transmits the force to explosion during the power stroke of the crankshaft, and the connecting rod has bearing at both of the end. The small end of the connecting has a solid or a split eye. This is the solid and split eye, and connecting the boss, this end is connecting to the piston to mean the gadgeton pin. The other end is called as a big end or connecting rod of the connecting rod. So basically, this end will be connected with the piston, and this is the connected with the crankshaft. So it has which stand with the heavy thrust, and it maybe have a strength and rigidity. It is usually dropped by the forgen I section. So next will be the crankshaft. So it is the main rotating shaft of the engine. This is the crankshaft, and it combines the connecting rod, converts the reciprocating motion to of the piston into rotatory motion. So basically here the connecting rod will be connected, and this is the crank, and this is the hole is called the crankshaft. So it basically converts the reciprocating motion to the rotatory motion. It has it is held in the position of the main bearing. There is a two main bearing of the support of the crankshaft, and it is made of the billet steel. This is very important. So it is made of billet steel, carbon steel, or nickel chromium, and other heat treatment of the alloy. So this is the main important thing. So this is the camshaft. So camshaft is used to ensure that the valve should open and close at a particular interval, so that the engine should work properly. So basically it contains a number of the engine can maybe in a two camshaft, and it is used to convert the rotatory motion into linear or a straight line motion by the help of these are the called cams. So by the help of cams we can convert the rotatory motion into a straight line motion, and the engine has many cams on the number of valves of the engine. So according to the engine, it may be 2, 3, 4, as much as your cylinder will be. So there may be that much of the your cams will be, and the additional cams are also provided to drive the fuel pump. So fuel pump is also connected from these cams, and a gear is provided to the cams have to drive the distributor or oil pump. So it is also connected with the distributor and oil pump. So detonation is also known as the engine knocking, or it is basically you can say that it is a spontaneous combustion inside the cylinder, and after the spark plug fires, it is similar to pre-ignition but it's different. So basically detonation is you can say as explosion. So it when the explosion will be happen in the inside the cylinder, so there will be a sound. So that sound is called as the engine knocking. So indication of the detonation are following. So ping sound or knocking, or drop of the in the exhaust gas temperature. So damage to the piston of the valve. So next will be the cause of detonation. So this is important. So over the environments of the ignition timing may be you can say the ignition is pre-ignition, maybe that cause also detonation. Linear air or the fuel mixture. So the fuel mixture is not properly, then may cause the detonation. Too much compression. If the fuel is too much compressed, then it may self-ignite, and so that it can cause the detonation. And engine overheating. If the engine is overheated, then again the temperature may be raised. So because the rise in temperature, the fuel may self burn. And the low octane fuel, if the fuel is low octane, then also it may cause detonation. So knocking. So high frequency vibration giving rise to the ping like sound, so that is called knocking. So it is caused by the low quality fuel deposit on the cylinder valve and the wrong spark plug. Basically deposits on the cylinder valves are the very common in the terms of knocking. So when the engine is moving, the piston is moving, and the fuel is burning, if the fuel is not properly proper grade, or you can say not a good quality fuel, then it may chance that there may be some of the quantity of fuel may stuck on the cylinder and it may cause knocking. So next will be a performance number. So basically, performance number is about the fuel. So basically, the performance of any fuel can be rated on the basis of the octane number. So octane number for it is for the petrol, and the cetane number is for the diesel. So basically, octane number is the measure, or you can say it is a standard for the any fuel. So basically, the in octane number we will measure the content having the fuel having how much fuel, how much they have hydrocarbons. So that is the percentage of hydrocarbon is measured in the octane number. So next will be tractive efforts. So tractive efforts are the basically torque available at the contact between the driving wheels and the road. That is called a tractive effort. So it is the force so required to haul a load. So basically, tractive efforts are the you can say the torque that is available on the wheel, driving wheel, to run a vehicle. So that the torque is called a tractive effort. So now let's discuss the induction of the fuel supply system. The induction system brings the air inside the engine and from atmosphere and mix it with the fuel and deliver it to the cylinder where the combustion occur. So basically, the fuel supply system has all of the work from the fuel tank to from taking air from the atmosphere to the it's giving to the cylinder. So basically, in SI engine there is a carburetor is available, and the CI engine is the fuel injector. So carburetion. So what is carburetion? Carburetion is basically a mixing of fuel, basically hydrocarbon and air, so that the mixture may be mixture become a very explosive, and for basically it is formed the term for the internal combustion engine. So this is basically the carburetor. So as you can see, so this is a carburetor, as you see. So it is it makes the air and fuel for the internal combustion engine, and the proper mixing of this fuel will be done, and then the fuel will be sent to the cylinder. So the next will be mixture requirement in SI engine. So amount of the fuel of the air depends upon the following. So the how much the amount of the fuel is going to the cylinder for burning. So it depends upon the engine displacement, the maximum RPM needed, the carburetor air flow capacity, how much the carburetor can intake the air, and the volumetric efficiency of the engine. So the fuel injector is basically present in the CI engine, compression ignition system engine. So basically, it supplies a pressurized fuel to the cylinder by the help of fuel pump. So basically, the fuel pump is available here in the fuel tank, or maybe below the fuel tank. So it is capable of closing and opening in many times per second. So in the fuel injector, so basically this is a nozzle type structure. So on the tip of it there is a valve, so that can open or close. So the amount of fuel can be applied to the engine is decided by the amount of fuel that time the fuel's injector stay open. So this is called the pulse width. It is controlled by the ECU, where ECU is the electronic control unit. So fuel rails pipe supplies the pressurized fuel to the all of the injectors. So this is the fuel pump. What you are seeing the this is the fuel pump. It moves the fuel to the engine, and many of the engine do not use the fuel pump. Basically, they use the gravity to feed the fuel. So from the tank to their injector system. But so the some of them of the use the this fuel pump. So types of nozzle in the CI engine. This is a very important. So there is a four types of nozzle: single hole nozzle, multi hole nozzle, pintail nozzle, or pintox nozzle. So let's understand the single hole nozzle. So these are the used in the open combustion chamber. It is a single injected hole which size is about 0.2 mm. This is very important. The size of the single hole nozzle is a 0.2, around it is 0.2 mm. The hole may be drilled centrically or it may be at angle. So if the nozzle, the single hole nozzle, is not necessary that it is the hole is just below centrically, it may be at any angle. So it's basically depends upon the engine to engine. So in multi-hole nozzle, the number of the holes range from the 4 to 18. So there may be to 4 hole or to up to 18 holes. And the size is greater than the single hole. So single hole is 0.2 mm hole diameter. And here the diameter is 1.5 to 0.355 mm. So the holes may be symmetrically or asymmetrically, it depends upon the application of the engine, and it can mix the fuel properly at low air velocity, generally in open combustion chamber. So the both of the nozzle, single hole nozzle and the multi hole nozzle, are used in the open combustion chamber. So pintail nozzle, this type of nozzle is provided with a projection called the pintail. So this is sticked out the mouth of the nozzle body. So this is basically called the pintail, and this is the pintail nozzle, and the projection of the cylindrical or the conical shape. So this is the cylindrical shape pintail, or it may be a conical shape pintail. So the fuel pressure are lower than a single or the multiple hole nozzle. So here the pressure is lower, and it is generally used high pre-ignition chamber or a high serial chamber due to the good atomization and the reduction. So what is a serial? Serial is basically a movement. So I am just drawing for you. So serial movement is just like this. So this like, so when the fuel is spread, so the fuel should move with the air like this way. So the fuel get atomized properly. So this is called the spiral movement. And now move to the pintax nozzle. So it is an advanced design of the pintail nozzle, and auxiliary hole is drilled in the nozzle. So basically this is same as the pintail nozzle, but there is an auxiliary nozzle for the small amount of fuel injection from here. And this is used to improve the cold starting performance. So in there is a big advantage in the disadvantage in tendency to choke the side hole. So basically this hole may be choked because it has not a much high pressure. The much high pressure is here. So this may choke. This is the biggest disadvantage of this nozzle. Now this is a distributor. Distributor basically distributes the electricity to different spark plug. So basically it basically controls the spark plug to when it has to ignite the spark. So it is a combination of electrical and mechanical controller of the spark plug. So basically this is a mechanical system where it rotates from point to point, and when the electric current will be passed to when it touch from here. So now it is touching, so the first plug is basically burning, and when this move and it will get to the third, so then the third spark plug will be ignite. So basically it is rotating, and so it is a mechanical system, and all of these are the electrical system. So it is basically electrical and mechanical controller unit. So turbocharge. Turbocharge is basically, you can say, it improves the efficiency of engine. So it increasing the efficiency of engine by this manner. So it mixes the fuel and the air with a very good quantity. So it compresses the air. It takes the atmospheric air and compress it, and then mix the fuel so that the fuel will get proper atmospheric air for combustion. So we will later study about the turbocharger. So benefits of turbocharger: it is usually less fuel and less noisy. It maintains the pressure at a very high altitude. So it reduces the emission of carbon oxide. So basically, carbon oxide, when the your fuel will be burned properly, there will be no carbon left, so there will be no carbon dioxide will be generated. So it reduces the emission of the CO2. Overall, the weight of the size of the engine is reduced than the normal engine. This is the biggest advantage, so that we are using this. So I hope this series will be helpful for you, and if you are not subscribed yet, then please subscribe this channel and press the bell icon so that you will get the next video notification, and share with this video with those who are fascinated in the automobile sector. And if you have any query, you can ask me in the comment, and if you have any suggestion, then also you can write in at the comment. And if you want to connect with me, then you can join us on the Instagram, and there I will provide you the PPT and the image of this lecture. So thanks for watching.